President Bashar al-Assad of Syria, thank you very much for talking to RT today.
You're most welcome in Damascus.
So, you know, many people were convinced a year ago that you wouldn't make it this far. But yet again, we're sitting in a newly renovated presidential palace and recording this interview. Who exactly is your enemy at this point?
My enemy is terrorism, the instability in Syria. This is our enemy. It's not about people. It's not about persons. The whole issue is not about me staying or leaving. It's about the country being safe or not. So this is the enemy that we've been fighting as Syrians.
You know, I've been here for the last 2 days and I had a chance to talk to a couple of people from Damascus. Some of them say that whether you stay or go doesn't really matter at this point anymore. What do you say to that?
I think for the president to stay or to leave is a popular issue. It's not a personal issue. And the only way to define this term precisely through the ballot boxes. So it's not about what we hear, it's about what we can get through that box. And that box will tell any president to stay or leave, very simply.
I think what they meant was that at this point, you are not the target anymore, Syria is.
I wasn't the target, I wasn't the problem anyway. You know, the West always created enemies. It was the communism, then it became the Islam, then it became Saddam Hussein, for different reasons. And now they wanted to create a new enemy, Bashar. So they said the problem is the president, so he has to leave. That's why we have to focus on the real problem, not to waste our time listening to what they say.
But do you personally believe, still believe, that you are the only man who can hold Syria together and the only man who can put an end what the world calls a civil war?
We have to look at it from two aspects. The first aspect is the constitution, and I have my authority through the constitution. According to this authority and to the constitution, I have to be able to solve the problem. But if we mean it that you don't have any other Syrian who can be president, no, any Syrian could be president. We have many Syrians who are eligible to be in that position. You cannot link the whole country only to one person always.
But you're fighting for your country. Do you believe that you are the man who can put end to the conflict and restore peace?
I have to be the man who can do that, and I hope so. I have. But it's not about the power of the president. It's about the whole society. I have to be precise about this. President cannot do anything without institutions and without support of the people. So the fight now is not president's fight. It's Syrian's fight. Every Syrian is involved in defending his country now.
It is. And a lot of civilians are dying as well in the fighting. So if you were to win this war, how would you reconcile with your people after everything that has happened?
Let's be, again, more precise. The problem is not between me and the people. I don't have a problem with the people. Because the United States is against me. The West is against me. Many Arab countries, including Turkey, which is not Arab, of course, against me. And if the people, the Syrian people are against me, how can I be here?
They're not against you.
If the whole world, or let's say big part of the world, including your people against you, are you a superman? Well, you're just a human being. So this is not logical. So it's not about reconciling with the people. And it's not about reconciliation between the Syrian and the Syrian. You don't have civil war. It's about terrorism and support coming from abroad to support terrorists to destabilize Syria. This is our war.
You still don't believe it's a civil war, because I know that there's a lot of, except for terrorism, which everyone believes takes place in Syria, there's also a lot of confession-based strife. For example, we all heard about the mother who has two sons. One son is fighting for the government forces, another one is fighting for the rebel forces. How is this not a civil war?
You have division, but division doesn't mean civil war. It's completely different. Civil war should be based on ethnical problem or sectarian problem. Sometimes you may have sectarian or ethnical tension, and tension doesn't mean problem. So if you have division in the same family or in a bigger tribe or whatever, or in the same city, it doesn't mean civil war. This is completely different, and that's normal. You should expect that.
When I asked about reconciling with your people, this is what I meant. I've heard you say on many different occasions that the only thing you care about is what Syrian people think of you and what Syrian people feel towards you and whether you should be a president or not. Aren't you afraid that at the end of the day, because there's been so much damage done to the country, that they won't care about the truth, but they will just blame you?
Yeah, this is a hypothetical question because what the people think is the right thing. So what they think, we have to ask them. But I don't have this information right now. So again, I'm not afraid about what they think about me. I'm afraid about my country. We have to be focused on that.
Okay. You know, for years, there has been so many stories about almighty Syrian army, omnipotent Syrian secret services. But then we see that, you know, the government forces aren't able to crush the enemy like people expected it would. And we see terrorist attacks take place in the middle of Damascus almost every day. Were there myths about the Syrian army and about the strong Syrian secret services?
Usually when you have army, when you have secret intelligence, these things should focus on external enemy, not internal enemy. Even if you have internal enemy like terrorism, you have society that could help you at least not to provide the terrorists with incubator. In that case, it's a new kind. We have a new kind of war. Terrorism through proxies. Either Syrians living in Syria or foreigner fighters coming from abroad. So it's a new style of war. This is first. So you have to adapt with this new style. It takes time. It's not easy.
Okay.
And to say this is easy as a normal or let's say traditional or regular war, no. It's much more difficult. Second, the support that they've been had, that's been offered to those terrorists in every aspect, armaments, money, political, is unprecedented. So you have to expect that it's going to be tough war and difficult war. You don't say it, you don't expect a small country like Syria to defeat all those countries that have been fighting us through proxies just in days or weeks.
Yeah, because when you look at it, I mean, on one hand, you have one leader with the army. He tells his army, go straight, go left, go right, and the army obeys. On the other hand, you have fractions of terrorists who have no one to unify them, no unified strategy to fight you. So how does that really happen when it comes to fighting each other?
This is another aspect of the problem, that those terrorists fighting from within the cities. In the cities, you have civilians. When you fight this kind of terrorists, you have to be aware that you should do the minimum damage to the infrastructure and minimum damage to the civilians, because you have civilians and you have to fight. You cannot leave terrorists just killing and destroying. So this is the difficulty in these kinds of war.
You know, the infrastructure, military infrastructure, economy is suffering. It's almost as if like Syria is going to fall into decay very soon, and the time is against you. In your opinion, how much time do you need to crush the enemy?
You cannot answer that question because no one claimed that he had the answer about when to end the war, unless we have the answer when they're going to stop smuggling foreign fighters from different part of this world, especially the Middle East and the Islamic world, and when they're going to stop sending armaments to those terrorists. If they stop, this is where I can answer you. I can tell you in weeks you can finish everything. It's not a big problem. But as long as you have continuous supply in men and armaments and everything else and logistics, it's going to be a long-term war.
Also, when you think about it, you have 4,000 kilometers of loosely controlled borders. So you have your enemy that can at any time cross over Jordan or Turkey, rearm, get medical care, and come back to fight you.
Exactly.
Actually, you deal with
no country
winning
in the world can seal the border. Sometimes they use this word, which is not correct. Even the United States cannot seal its border with Mexico, for example. Maybe the same for Russia, which is a big country. So no country can seal the border. You can only have better situation on the border when you have good relation with your neighbors, something that we don't have, at least with Turkey now. Turkey support more than any other country the smuggling of armaments and terrorists.
Can I ask you something? I've been in Turkey recently, and people there are actually very worried that war will happen between Syria and Turkey. Do you think a war with Turkey is a realistic scenario?
Rationally, no, I don't think in that regard, for two reasons. The war needs public support, and the majority of the Turkish people don't need this war. So I don't think any rational official would think about going against the will of the public in his country. The same for the Syrian people. So it's not the conflict or the difference is not between the Syrian people and the Turkish people. It's about the government and the official, between our official and their official, because of their politics. So I don't see any war between Syria and Turkey in the horizon.
When is the last time you spoke to Erdogan, and how did the talk end?
May 2011, mm-hmm. after he won the elections.
So you just congratulated him?
Yeah, just
and that was the last time?
It was the last time.
Who is shelling Turkey? The government forces or the rebels?
In order to find the answer, you need a joint committee between the two armies in order to know who shell who. Because on the borders you have a lot of terrorists who have mortars, so they can do the same. Mm-hmm. You have to go investigate the bomb itself, the place and so on. And that didn't happen. We asked the Turks, the Turkish government, to have this committee. They refused. So you cannot have the answer. But when you have this terrorist on your border, you don't exclude them from doing so, because the Syrian army doesn't have any order to shell the Turkish land, because we don't find any interest in this, and we don't have any enmity with the Turkish people. We consider them as brothers, so why to do it? Unless that happens by mistake, you need the investigation. So far we don't have the answer. Because
so you accept that it may be mistakenly from the government forces?
That could happen. This possibility. In every war you have mistakes. You know, in Afghanistan, they always talk about friendly fire. Mm-hmm. If you can kill your soldier. So that it means in every war that could happen. Mm-hmm. But we cannot say yes.
Tell me something. Why has Turkey, that you call a friendly nation, become a foothold for the opposition?
Not Turkey. Only Erdogan's government. Mm-hmm. Only, just to be precise, not the Turkish people. Turkish people need good relation with the Syrian people. This is Erdogan. I think he believes that if Muslim Brotherhood take over in the region, and especially in Syria, he can guarantee his political future. This is one reason. The other reason, personally, he thinks that he is the new Sultan of the Ottoman, and he can control the region as it was during the Ottoman Empire under a different, let's say, umbrella, which is the Islamic, but not the Ottoman Empire, not to be Khalifa. But in his heart, he thinks that he's Khalifa. Mm-hmm. These are the main two reasons for him to change or to shift his policy from zero problems to zero friends. Mm-hmm.
But it's not just the West that opposes you at this point. You have so many enemies in the Arab world. Why? And that's to say, like 2 years ago, when someone heard your name in the Arab world, they would straighten their ties. And now on the first occasion, they betray you. Why do you have so many enemies in the Arab world?
They're not enemies. Some of them, the majority of the Arab governments support Syria in their heart, okay. But they don't dare to say that explicitly.
Why not?
Under pressure by the West, sometimes under pressure by the petrodollar in the Arab world.
Who supports you from the Arab world?
Many countries support Syria by their heart, but they don't dare to say that explicitly. But first of all, Iraq. Iraq plays a very active role in supporting Syria during the crisis, because it's a neighboring country, and they understand and they recognize that if you have a war inside Syria, you'll have war in the neighboring country, including Iraq. I think other countries, they have a good position, like Algeria, Oman, mainly. And those are the countries. And other countries, I wouldn't count all of them, but I would say they have positive position, but without taking actions.
Saudi Arabia and Qatar, why are they so adamant about you resigning? And how would an unstable Middle East fit their agenda?
Let's be frank, I cannot answer on their behalf. Mm-hmm. They have to answer that question. But what I could say, that the problem between Syria and many countries, mm-hmm. whether in the Arab world or regional or in the West, that we keep saying no when we think that we have to say no. That's the problem. And some countries, they believe that they can control Syria through orders or through money or petrodollars, and this is impossible in Syria. This is the problem. Maybe they want to play a role. We don't have problem. They can play a role. Whether they deserve or not, they can play a role. But not to play a role at the expense of our interests.
But is it about controlling Syria or about exporting their vision of Islam to Syria?
You cannot put it as a government policy sometimes. Sometimes you have institutions in certain countries. Sometimes you have personnel who try to promote this, but they don't announce it as official policy. So